How was everyone's night last night? Good sleep? Horrible?
Horrible? It's often like that after a meeting for some reason. Yeah.
Bit nervous. What do you feel nervous about, Anna?
We need a mic if we're going to do that.
Yeah, I didn't know we'd started officially. Well.
I didn't expect this.
You don't have to answer, it's all right. I was
well, I guess I gave myself permission to just be here and absorb yesterday and not ask any questions and just sort of listen and take it in. And today I think I'm preparing myself to ask the questions I do want to ask, so, and then the energy is heightened.
Yep.
So I feel a bit nervous today.
Yeah. A bit nervous about asking questions?
Well, yes, I think so.
Or are you more nervous about the answers?
I think it could be that, and it could be asking the questions in public and
yep.
in YouTube.
Yeah. A lot of people are worried about asking the questions in public and also worried that it sort of, in the end, it's basically the answer is available to the world sort of thing. But we find there's a lot of advantages in that in terms of how much other people are helped by you asking the question.
And if you think about how you've been helped by other people's questions.
Exactly what I was going to say. Yeah. It has been a huge help to see the person asking the questions and hearing the questions and hearing the answers.
So yeah.
I feel okay with it, but it makes me a bit nervous.
Yeah. And particularly when the media can grab things now and use it negatively and
yes,
things like
course.
That.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's okay, but...
Yeah. So I understand that. So how's everyone today? A bit stressed out today. You feel a bit more stressed out today, many of you, don't you? What we wanted to do firstly is just address an issue for the Greek people who have invited us to Greece. And how many of you are left in the audience now? We could just... So, about half of what there were. What's happening is many of our Greek brothers and sisters have been in particular triggered by myself and Mary's actions over the last week. And what we'd like to do is just explain to you how that's the case. You see, when we visit a location, many people have the expectation that at some point they will be able to have personal time with us where we can do some one-on-one type things. Now, myself and Mary very rarely do that nowadays unless we see some sort of really major benefits to doing it for the persons involved or for other people or something like that. And so what finishes up happening is that when we go to a location, generally there is a very high expectation that we get to have one-on-one time with people. Now, because of that high expectation, there is a general unwillingness to share us or to share time with us. So in other words, instead of somebody inviting us over where there's five or six other people, they want to have one-on-one or just a couple with us. Now, of course, the bigger things get with regard to the divine truth on earth, the more impossible that becomes because more and more people have a desire to spend one-on-one time, but you know, eventually you'll get to a point where if we were just spending one-on-one time with people, we would never get anything else done in our lives, including any of our own emotional processing work. The other thing that happens with myself and Mary, whether we're travelling or not, whether we're home or travelling, is that we have a focus on the... can we just ask... Can you just turn off all the...
That's done, I think.
No, that's still on. Could you just turn off all the fluoros, please, for me? If that's okay?
Just
the front ones. Could they just all go off? They don't need to be on. Okay. It's no good turning on lights that we don't need, is it? Not very economical. All right. What were we talking about? Yes, that's right.
Greece, brothers, midstream.
Yeah. So going back to the part of the discussion about our brothers and sisters here in Greece. Basically, generally what happens is myself and Mary are firstly focused on our relationship with God and our relationship with each other and dealing with our emotions that actually impede those two relationships. Does that make sense? Now, that happens wherever we go. We don't put that on hold just because we travel to a new location. Does that make sense to everyone? Wherever we go in the world, our first priority is actually doing that work. Now, because of that, we come to a place like Greece and, you know, normally for most people there'd be a temptation to see the sights and, you know, do all of those other things. Well, our focus is still our relationship with God, our relationship with each other and dealing with the emotions that block those two things. So if those emotions come up, and generally for us they do, if those emotions come up...
certainly for myself at the moment, there's a lot,
for myself
a lot of emotions up.
Yeah. So when those emotions come up, we drop everything else and do that. Does that make sense? So if we have an arrangement with somebody, we'll ring up that person and just say, I'm sorry, but we have to cancel our arrangement for today. That's what we do. We do that whether we're home or travelling. We do that constantly. So many people we make arrangements with, and most of our arrangements, you could say, are tentative arrangements in the sense they can only ever be tentative because of those two priorities that we have. The priority, firstly, with our relationship with God and then our relationship with each other and dealing with the emotions. So if an emotion comes up and we're just about to go around to somebody's place for lunch, then we focus on dealing with the emotion and we don't go around to their place for lunch. Does that make sense to everyone? We deal with that first. We make our apologies, of course. We phone them and let them know that something's come up. And quite frequently at home, we might make arrangements to have a meeting and then we cancel the meeting at the last minute. We might make arrangements to meet with some of the teams in the God's Way of Love organisation and then right at the last minute cancel them because something's come up for us on that particular day. And many in Australia are now starting to get used to that happening. So, you know, they're used to us changing plans depending on what emotions are present for us. When we travel to a new location, the temptation for anybody when they're in a new location is to investigate the location as much as possible and suppress their emotions as much as they possibly can while they're doing it. Does that make sense? So for most people, when they go to a new location, there's so much restlessness in that corner there. It's all right. When we go to a new location, there is this temptation to investigate the location, spend as much of our time investigating the location as we possibly can, and suppress our emotions where we possibly can in order to do that. Now, many of you who have visited Greece might have found that already happening for you, where you've suppressed certain emotions that have been triggered. What we find is when we travel, the emotional triggers are intensified, right? And actually, they're a great opportunity when you're travelling to deal with all sorts of emotions that come up, one after the other, if you really desire to do it. When we suppress it, we lock ourselves down, and then by the time we go back home, we're so locked down that it takes days or sometimes weeks for us to reopen again if we do that. So myself and Mary choose to not do that ourselves. Now, what happens then is that when we go to a location as well, because most people have not seen us regularly or have seen us, like in the case of Greece, it was 3 years ago since we came here, all of our friends that we have in Greece that we met 3 years ago haven't had personal time with us for 3 years. Right? And so there's a strong desire for each of them to have some personal time because they sort of have the viewpoint that many people in Australia get personal time with us and so forth, and it's because they're in a different location of the world they don't get personal time and so on. The reality is quite different to that, actually. Many people in Australia actually haven't had personal time with us, but that's a separate issue. But what happens is that they then project competition at each other and project neediness at myself and Mary that we fit into time when they have time available to spend time with us. Now, the problem with that is a number of different problems, actually. Firstly, it neglects the fact that myself and Mary are still working through our emotions. And so there are going to be times when we're going to need to say, no, I'm sorry, but we can't come today, right? Secondly, it neglects the fact that if more people join together, we could share the time together, and therefore each person would get more time. Does that make sense? Like, so the beauty of having a group like this is that we all get time to spend together. Now imagine if we had to visit each of you individually. There's 70 or so of us here, and so imagine visiting each couple individually. So let's say there were, you know, some of you are single, so, you know, it might take 40 or 50 visits to visit each of you individually. Now, because of that, it's only the questions that you think to ask that will ever get answered. Whereas in a group like this, or in a larger group where we're having dinner together or something like that, there's all sorts of things going on in the interaction, and we get to have lots of different experiences as a result of that, which actually makes it more powerful for everyone involved. So what we're finding, though, is that oftentimes we go to a location and the projection from the people for us to spend personal time with them is so great that it becomes so unloving that we can't even consider spending time with them, even though we would like to. Do you understand why that's the case? The way we work is this. If I am enabling you to stay in an addictive emotion, then I am not loving you. So whenever I notice an addictive emotion in play between you and myself, I will generally address that. And Mary's the same. She will generally address that as well. So when we are addressing those things emotionally, sometimes if there's a projection of neediness that's very, very strong, that feels very demanding and lots of expectation in it, even though we would like to visit you, love would dictate that we shouldn't visit you while that emotion's present. Does that make sense? Because if I love you, I will not help you stay in an addiction that is going to damage your relationship with God or your relationship with others, if I really loved you. And so what we do is we often go, oh boy, this is sad actually. We wanted to go and visit those particular people, but now we can't because of that really intense projection we're getting from them. And if we went there, we would be just helping them in that projection. Now, the problem is that when we do that, when we no longer feed the addiction, most of us most of us on the path of divine truth are still in heavy addiction. And what happens is whenever an addiction isn't met, we get quite upset. We get angry and bitter or resentful about an addiction not being met. We don't understand why our addiction isn't being met, right? And so we have a tendency then to be angry at the person who's no longer meeting our addiction, which means that first we feel, myself and Mary feel the projection of neediness, we don't respond to the neediness, the person who's in the addiction of neediness then gets angry with myself and Mary. Now we're receiving two emotions that are unloving from the person, the original neediness and expectation, and the second, rage and anger, for us not meeting the original emotion. Now that then means that we definitely can't go and visit that person, because they're in that state where they're now being unloving twice and not wanting to see it. Now, we would prefer that people... one other thing I'd like to mention about that is that when that happens, when that second anger happens, now spirits who are angry with myself and Mary, and by the way, there's quite a few billion of them in the spirit world who are angry with myself and Mary, those spirits now have a mechanism through you to connect to and keep you in that state of anger and rage. So now you can be angry with us without even really understanding why you're angry, because you've now got a heap of spirits on your back who are also projecting that same anger towards us, right? Now, our suggestion is that all doesn't have to happen if there was more of a loving attitude with regard to any visit that we make, and that is a loving attitude of sharing the time together rather than trying to create specific times where we have alone time with Mary and myself, where you have alone time with Mary and myself. And we personally find that the alone time that gets created naturally, in other words, the law of attraction through different events, creates alone time fairly naturally once people engage their passions and desires. If you do not engage your passions and desires, and instead you're projecting a lot of neediness at myself and Mary, your passions and desires are in that place not engaged, And therefore, it's highly unlikely you're going to naturally attract alone time with myself and Mary. That's the irony of that as well. In addition, once we do have the alone time, what we find is we might have a bit of an interaction. For many people, those small interactions create large emotional issues. And then they wonder why they even wanted alone time with us in the first place, right? And that frequently happens too. My suggestion for the people in Greece was a suggestion that we actually made to Katerina before we came. If I can illustrate, with Katerina sent us an email before we came to Greece. Really, people in Greece were really strongly desiring us to come to Greece. So Katerina sent us an email expressing those desires, and so did Christina and a number of others sent emails responding to those desires. Does that make sense? Now, what we did is we noticed after a while Katerina was starting to have to try and control what we did when we came, weren't you? You were starting to want to determine what happened and so forth. So we sent Katerina a very specific email addressing Katerina's emotions. For many of the others in Greece, you probably never saw that email. I don't know if you've ever shown any one of them that email. It did go to everyone. So pretty much everyone then in Greece must have seen that email. And as a result of that, Katerina herself dealt with some emotions about the level of control, didn't you? You felt some emotions about the level of control you had and so forth. So my suggestion is to the others in Greece to re-look at the comments that we made in that email to Katerina that you have received and feel about the level of expectation and demand you had in us coming here, in myself and Mary coming to Greece. Does that make sense? Katerina? Just wait for it. Go.
And I wanted to say that I was not taking your free will under consideration at all.
Not at all. Yeah.
It was only what I thought would be loving for you.
Mm-hmm.
And it was all what I wanted.
Yeah.
It had nothing to do with, maybe they have a different opinion.
Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe they want to do something else. I never consider until Arthur says, well, wait a minute, they have free will.
Yeah.
So.
And often we find the consideration certainly isn't there with regard to the fact that we have a priority on God first, our soul, our relationship next, and dealing with those emotions. We often find that people expect us to put our emotions on hold for the sake of talking to them about something. And that's what we're trying more and more to not do anymore. We're trying to, whenever we go to a new location, we're trying to allow our emotions. You okay? Yeah. We're trying to allow our emotions to be present first. Yeah, yeah. Does that make sense? If we can have a mic, if there's a second mic. No, you need a mic. No. Don't. Now you're
Sorry.
Not going to get to ask.
I just want to say that I haven't.
Stop. Can I just address something?
Yes.
You want to put up your hand and ask a question.
It's not a question.
Or a statement or whatever it is. However, you're not waiting for the microphone to come to you. And don't you see that as an unloving thing? Because half the people here won't be able to hear. Secondly, the people who are listening to the recording won't be able to hear. Can you see that is not considering any of those factors?
Mm-hmm.
Can you see that? Now how do you feel? You feel like what I've said is unfair. You feel that?
No, I don't feel it's unfair.
So why are you angry?
I don't feel it's unfair. I was over-enthusiastic with the piece of information that I want to give because I heard an assumption that all of us in Greece had seen the email and I wanted to make it clear that I haven't seen that email.
No worries. We'll ask Katerina and she will be able to send you the email.
Yeah,
if you give her the details. I'm not addressing the fact whether you've seen it or not seen it. What I'm addressing is the expectations that are within the soul of the people involved. And this is where you've got to be very careful, is that every time we have an expectation, we are automatically being unloving. Automatically. Your expectation to be able to speak without me even like pointing at you to speak is an unloving expectation. Does that make sense? So
yeah.
While enthusiasm might have driven
the
comment, the reality is that the expectation itself is unloving.
Yeah.
Yes. So this is where I'm saying we need to address these emotions, these unloving emotions. Yeah. The divine love path is all about addressing the unlovingness within us. And every single person, not to single yourself out, every single person obviously has various degrees of unlovingness because we're all not yet at one with God. So even myself, I have various degrees of unlovingness also within me right at the moment because I'm not yet in that state. So we need to be very conscious of that, personally conscious of that, and attempt to practice love rather than keep on acting the way we normally would act in an environment.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But I accept your comment.
Thank you.
Katerina.
Thank you.
Knows you. Do you know Katerina's email address?
Yes.
Sure. So just email Katerina and she will send the details. Yep. Someone else had their hand up too? No? Where is it? That's the second mic over there, is it? Yep, there is. So what I'm getting at is that often in your interaction with myself and Mary, you have opportunities to demonstrate love. And yet, often what we find is that myself and Mary often feel just demand upon demand upon demand upon demand rather than opportunities to express love. Now, we do understand that many of you have a lot of very important questions that you would like to ask. And we do understand, and one of the reasons why we make hours and hours and hours of our time available is because we do understand that, the desire for your desire to have those questions answered is very strong, and that you have a strong desire to get closer to God and closer to love. And so therefore you have a strong desire to, get those questions answered. But we've got to be very careful with our questions, because often what we start doing is we start feeling that our questions are more important than anybody else's questions, and that is an issue of selfishness. We also think that our questions are more important than AJ and Mary's life and them living their life, and that is also an issue of selfishness. And we also believe that even after 5 or 6 hours of myself and Mary speaking with you, that we should still supply more, even after we've spoke for 6 hours sometimes straight. Yesterday, nearly 6 hours straight we spoke, and yet there was still afterwards people wanting more than that, right? And that is an issue of love. Can you see that as an issue of love? And so this is why I wanted to raise this issue with you today, this afternoon. Now, we are very keen to help and encourage as many people as we can on the path. And we are very keen to help and encourage people to ask their questions that they need to ask to help their own personal progress. We are also very aware that every question you can ask has probably been asked before, right? In that there are 6 and a bit billion people on the planet, and many of us are inspired by billions of spirits. And often the same questions keep arising. And for that reason, we record these sessions because we would like these questions that are asked to be presented to anyone who wishes to know the answer rather than just to one person. So even now when it comes to emails, I generally don't answer questions that I've already answered before. And I generally also don't answer questions unless the person agrees that I can put the question and its answer on the internet under a frequently asked questions section, which we're just starting to create now, so that any person can see the answers to those questions. Does that make sense? And please understand that we, myself and Mary, have a strong desire to connect with all of you. We have a strong desire to spend personal time with all of you. However, it is just not possible for one person or two people to do that with thousands and thousands and thousands of people. Does that make sense? It's not possible to do that on a regular basis. And we just need to take the opportunities as they arise in our interactions to discuss things as they come up. That's what we do in our life, and my suggestion to everyone who's listening to this presentation is to do the same thing, just to take the opportunities as they arise. Now, bear in mind that not only myself and Mary, but really any single person who's following the divine love path will have the same attitude with their emotions generally, in that their relationship with God will come first, then their relationship with their partner will come next, and developing in love and therefore releasing the emotions that cause unloving behaviour will become next in that process, and developing in love is the highest priority. Now, if you remember that with every single person who you interact with on the path, then you won't have high expectations that they do what you want when you want it to occur. But rather, you'll be very considerate of the fact that, wow, they might be going through an emotion today. So for example, most people, I feel it's polite to actually call a person before you visit them generally, isn't it? Because if you call them and you find, and they then have an opportunity to say, well, no, actually, today's not a good day for me, right? Because today I'm dealing with this and that or whatever, and today's not a good day for me, but we can arrange something next week or something like that. You see, a lot of times what we do is we almost impose ourselves in other people's lives because we don't want to feel a group of emotions. And usually it's groups of emotions associated with abandonment and the friendships and what happened with our parents and all sorts of emotions. We start to have the viewpoint that we should be able to involve ourselves in other person's life without their will being involved. Many parents feel this about their children, for example. How many times have you wished your mum didn't come over or your dad didn't come over because you were doing something that was really... And yet they come over anyway because they feel entitled to. Now that happens quite frequently, I know, in many countries of the world, including ours. And, you know, in the end, all it is the parent thinking they're entitled to push the children around in their lives, right? So oftentimes with these emotions, we grow up with them and then we just view it as normal. We view, you know, things as normal. Another thing we view as normal is that if we give something to someone, we then view as normal that we should be able to take something from them. And this happens a lot with myself and Mary, in that we have a little donation box that's at the back. The way myself and Mary live is via donations. We don't have any other source of income. And so we just have a donation box up the back of most auditoriums. Some of you may have noticed it, some of you may not. I didn't mention anything about it yesterday. And what we do is, you know, people then donate to the box, and it's usually anonymous. You know, in other words, we don't know who puts the donations in there unless somebody writes a little note along with their donation or a letter or something, which is often happens. But aside from that, we don't know who puts the donations in. What we find, though, is that many people, along with the donation, comes an expectation. And that is, I've now paid for a service, now I expect somebody to deliver. Does that make sense? And we often find, actually, that a lot of people want to tell us that they've made the donation for that reason. You know, they tell us they've made a donation and then we receive the donation, but along with the donation comes an expectation. Now, generally, with myself and Mary, when that happens personally, we give back the donation because we don't see that donation as a gift, but rather we see it as a payment for a service that is about to be rendered. Does that make sense? Now, all of these things are all to do with aspects of love, and the reality is we're coming along to a session like this to learn about love. And then many times in our general interactions, even with myself and Mary, we're not actually in a loving interaction and we're not questioning it. We're not looking at it and seeing that it's actually not a loving interaction. And we often are not self-reflective about the unloving interactions that we're involved in. Does that make sense? Now, what I suggest to you is that if you're not dedicated to love on this path, you are going to find almost everything we finish up doing, when I say we, myself and Mary finishes up doing, is going to trigger you in some way, right? If you're not dedicated to love and truth, sooner or later something is going to happen that upsets you, that you feel one of your addictions is not getting met. My suggestion is every time you feel even an ounce of anger or resentment about anything that myself and Mary have done, first focus on what happened inside of you. Because remember, anger and resentment is not love. And I certainly don't feel anger and resentment towards any way that I've been treated from a lot of people, and continually get treated by a lot of people. And what I'm trying to illustrate through that example to you is there is no reason for any of you to do that either, to be angry and resentful about how another person treats you, even if that person treats you in an unloving manner. Because that's the real measure of love. If we can't love the people who are like, if we can't love the people who treat us badly, then we're only loving our friends. We're only loving our friends. And if we're only loving our friends, a murderer loves his friends. So what difference do we have between ourselves and a murderer? None really, is there? He loves his friends. We love our friends. We hate our enemies. He hates his enemies. He might murder his enemies. That might be the only difference between the two of us, where we don't murder them. We just slaughter them with our words or with our emotional projections. So what we need to start doing is learn how to love the people who upset us. And to be frank, many times we are going to be upset by a person who's in more truth than ourselves. We are many times going to be upset because we have so many addictions in play that interacting with them will trigger every one of those addictions in play, quite often simultaneously, you know, four or five of them getting triggered at the same time. Does that make sense? So we need to just allow the process to refine us rather than blaming or resentful or allowing spirits to manipulate us away from the truth, you know, away from the divine truth. Now, I know that was quite a bit of a long-winded introduction to our session today, and many of you feel a little like you've been told off, which is an emotion that you do need to address. The issue is an issue of love. And myself and Mary are finding we want to be more firm with everyone about when unloving behaviour is being displayed. Because we feel quite strongly that these sessions are all about love. They're all about learning to get closer to God, in other words, and receive God's love. They're all about learning how to love other people on the planet more than we currently do. And if we come to a session and then display an unloving behaviour in the session itself, then it almost seems like a waste of our time to come to the session, doesn't it? Wouldn't it be better for us to learn about love as a part of these sessions and our part of our interactions together? So that's what we wanted to raise with you first. And it's just something we've noticed here in Greece, but we've also noticed it in other locations that we've travelled to, haven't we, darling? Like, sure. Just how there's sort of people who want to grab the time and use the time, but they don't want to share that time. And we want to share ourselves with more than just one person or two people. We want to share with everyone we meet. Yeah. Mm. Mm. Do you want to say anything about it? You've felt a few things about it.
Yeah. Personally, I find it really difficult to address issues of love of us. I find that hard because it feels like telling people off, and I don't like that feeling. And I'm still in the process of grieving this desire that I have to, I don't know how to explain it, to have friendships. And at times I often feel like there's a demand for a commodity from us rather than a connection with us. And
rather than a friendship.
Rather than a friendship connection with us. And I even feel unworthy of being a commodity that people would want something from. So the whole subject is quite emotionally charged for me. I feel like I desire a connection with people's hearts from my heart. And often what I'm going through at the moment is just triggering this feeling that people desire to have truth, but not the heart connection with us. And because I feel so unworthy of giving the truth even, I feel quite alone and sort of useless a lot. Yeah, I think that's all that I wanted to say.
Do you understand where Mary's coming from there? Like, what we often find, we want to have friendships with many people, but when there's the demand and expectation and neediness and then anger when we don't give what the person thinks we should, none of that is what a friend would do. That's all stuff of what a person who's yet to learn more about love would need to do, but it's not what a friend would do. And what we would, and so therefore it's hard for us to feel close to people who do that with us. Does it make sense? Just like it would be hard for you to feel close to somebody who's angry with you or bitter with you or needy with you. You know, you might give them certain things that you decide to give them, but at the end of the day, you won't feel close to them because there's not this free-flowing energy of, you know, just free-flowing conversation and free-flowing enjoyment of your time together that there could be. And what we find a lot is that it's sort of almost like we get set up as mum and dad in your life. So what we find for many people listening to our presentation is that I'm like your daddy who never loved you and didn't care for you and abandoned you. And Mary's like your mummy who is controlling, manipulative. You know, I'm not saying Mary's like this, but there's a feeling Mary is like this, just like there's the feeling that I'm like your daddy who never gave you anything. And then what we find finishes up happening is we get all of these emotional projections from people that actually should be feeling about those things towards their mum and dad, not towards us, because we've only just entered their life, you see. And so what we find is that many of the emotions that are unhealed towards daddy get played out with myself, between myself and the person involved, and many of the emotions that are unhealed with mum get played out with Mary. And towards Mary. So sometimes we feel quite strange because it sort of feels like we're wanting to be friends with every person we meet, basically. But the corresponding feeling coming from the other person is often a feeling of you're my daddy. You've got to give me approval. You've got to give me acceptance. And you've got to give me a feeling that I'm a good girl and that that I'm doing the right thing. And I don't want to hear from you truth, because if I hear from you truth, it feels like I'm doing something wrong, and then I feel bad. And so the projection at me is like that. And then the projection at Mary is, I'm competitive with you for daddy's approval and attention. And Mary gets that quite strongly from many, many women in particular. And then there's also the many other projections that you receive. I can't remember them all right now.
I don't think we need to listen.
We don't need to listen.
But I also feel there's something more than that, babe, and that is that there's an issue of the pedestal that you often placed on. And I think the reason that it's so emotional for me is that I feel that we really strongly want to... that's not the purpose of how we teach. That I'm really struggling to express it. But we're here to teach that we're not different. And when people treat us as quite different, I feel like I'm failing as a teacher also to demonstrate that...
Whereas I don't feel that, but...
Yeah, that's we my feel feeling.
Mary feels a little differently than myself because I've already had to work through many of these emotions that Mary's still working through. So we often feel a little differently about things. I realise that being a leader, you often feel quite alone because there are a lot of projections at you to lead, but then whenever anybody disagrees with you, they're angry with you and upset with you, and so forth. And over 8 years of doing this, I've obviously had to deal with quite a few emotions about all of those things. And so I'm now used to sort of receiving those projections without being invested in people treating me any differently. And by the way, I'm not saying what I've just said to you, all of what I've just said to you, in order to make you treat me differently. What I'm saying it in order to ask you to consider aspects of love that are involved in the treatment that you meet out, not only with me but with other people in your life as well. So what I'm trying to do is confront the issues of love, not say, you're not treating us well enough or anything like that. That's not what I feel.
And that's what I was trying to express initially, that I am grieving my investment in friendships in what I desire to receive from other people, because in the end, when I love, I don't expect or I don't have an investment in this concept of friendship, and so I see it as my own grief. You know, that's, you're not responsible for that. That's just what I'm processing through at the moment. So
in other words, you shouldn't work through these emotions that are based around unlovingness just because Mary feels bad about it.
No.
Does that make sense? What you need
to do...
Which
is why I feel uncomfortable even talking about it, I think. And yeah.
Whereas I don't feel bad about how you treat me. Like, all I feel is, oh, there's neediness there, so I can't go there. You know, I don't feel bad that I can't go there. I don't feel like it's terrible. I don't feel a terrible loss about it. I do feel it's a bit sad in the sense that it stops me from being closer to the person. But love, a lack of love always stops you from being closer to a person. That's the reality of life. And I've dealt with pretty much all of my investments in other people. So I don't have an investment in how you treat me. Mary still does have a bit of an investment of how people treat her, and that's why she feels the grief of it more than I do. However, that all being said, it's still appropriate for me to bring this up with you, because it's important to understand unlovingness and where we're being unloving. You see, the world's view of love, and this is something we want to discuss more with you over the coming weeks, the world's view of love and God's view of love are very, very different from each other. And you and I have been absorbed and soaking in, like a sponge, the world's view of love for all of our life. So we're bound to have absorbed, just like a sponge would, all of the polluting aspects of what the world's view of love is. We'll have all these concepts that we totally believe are true, that we feel accept in our life as the truth about love, and the reality is that they are distorted and they keep us away from God and away from real love. And so whenever we notice something that does that, it, on the part of a person who notices it, there is a onus really to talk about that with the people involved. And that's what I'm doing with you now, talking about that. Please don't judge yourselves or feel resentful about this discussion, but rather just ask yourselves, is my conception of love God's conception of love? And if it's not, do I want to know the difference? Like, do I want to know when my conception of love is different to God's conception of love? Now, a few weeks ago, we gave a talk, didn't we, in Melbourne, which we'll talk a bit more about in detail later on today, about the world's view of what it thinks love is and what it thinks love does and what it thinks love feels like. Some of you may have already seen that presentation. I think it's now loaded on YouTube, isn't it? But we haven't produced a DVD of it yet, I don't think. So it's on YouTube, but not on a DVD. My suggestion is, if you haven't seen that presentation, have a good look at it.
I think we're going to recap it today.
We want to recap some of it today, but we'll recap it faster than what we presented the original material. So, because we want to add to the material. In fact, over the coming weeks and months, there's a whole sections of what the world views love to be compared to what God's love and what God views love to be, and there's whole sections of differences between that. And we want to cover a lot of those sections of differences so that you can identify in your own life when you think you're loving, but actually from God's perspective, not being loving. Does that make sense? We want to be able to compare what God's view of love is and what the world's view of love is, and give you logical examples of the difference between the two forms of love. One being a form of love, God's love, the other, in my opinion, not being love, but rather being fear and other emotions that are not even connected with love. Now, the second thing I'd like to address with you, so that's the first.
Is there anyone
is there
who
any
would
questions
like
about
to
that?
Say anything about that?
Christina, thanks. Just hang on a sec, there's something wrong with the mic, so. We've had a trouble with one mic, so. It's on. You only have to turn it on, so. We need the other mic, so. Yep, thanks. So it's probably the battery, so we just need to replace it.
Yeah, I was thinking that maybe the example with the dinner would be good.
An example?
The example about the dinner on we were planning, and Nico and I want to go with you.
That'd be a good example, yes. You want to mention it?
Yeah, lots of emotions about this.
Sure.
You expressed your desire to have more people.
Originally you came up and said, oh, we'd like to take you out to dinner. So we said, yes, we'd love to go out to dinner with you. We want to spend some time with you for sure.
And you said that more people, it would be nice to have more people coming. Mm-hmm. My first reaction was like, yes, but no.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So can you feel why the no? What was the reason?
Yes, I already told Mary it's about my brother taking away the attention of my mother.
Yes.
And I was struggling to get her attention all the time.
Yep.
And she was a very busy woman.
Yep.
Anyway, and then the next trigger was like, because I knew Nico wouldn't like that, to tell him that it's really more loving to give a chance to other people.
Yeah.
Because Mary said, I leave it to you, who you want to bring along.
Yeah.
And I feel like I want to give other people the chance, as like I try to email a lot of people and let them
Can
know.
Can I stop you though there?
Yeah.
The reality is the emotion is the truth. And the emotion you feel is that you don't want to give the other people a chance. You would like to actually have us personally. Now, intellectually, you do have a thought that it'd be the loving thing to give the other people the chance.
Yeah.
But the emotion is still inside of you. Does that make sense?
Yes, yes.
So while the emotion is still inside of you, you'll be saying one thing intellectually to them and the emotion coming out of it. So you'll be saying to them, oh, we'd like you to come along. We're going to go out to dinner with Mary and AJ. We'd like you to come along with us. But at the same time, the emotion coming out of you will be, please don't say yes. Please don't say yes at the same time. Does that make sense?
Yes.
That's what's coming out of the soul. And so they're going, oh, what do I do now? Like, on one hand, I feel like she's asking me the question, but on the other hand, the feeling I'm getting is that she doesn't really want me to come. Like, and so can you see how even that emotion is still really dictating and is going to dictate the reaction?
Yes.
Yeah.
But there's also another injury I have to please other people.
Yes.
So, and that's a big one lately. These days, a lot of triggers about this. And so it's confusing sometimes when it's a pure desire to help people or when it's the injury.
Yep.
And
so the answer is you could say to myself and Mary, I'm sorry, but we don't want to go have anybody else there. We just want to have you. That would have been a truthful thing to say.
Yes.
I'm sorry, no, we're happy to just want you. And if we can't have you, then we don't want to go out to tea with you.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And that's okay. That's a statement of truth. Even though there might be some unloving things to deal with in that statement, we'd be perfectly happy to accept that statement. The second thing is to deal with some of the emotions aside, you know, how you're always trying to get mum's attention and your brother always got it instead. Or the third emotion that got triggered was having to tell Nico when you know Nico is going to be upset about it.
Yeah.
In other words, that's the emotion of, I want to prevent the man from feeling what he's going to feel.
Yeah, and then reject me.
Yeah, you know, is he going to get upset with me for it? Or is he going to get upset with them? Or what is he going to do?
Mm.
And can you see just in one little interaction like that, there's three or four opportunities to deal with some emotions that dictate unloving behaviour. And my suggestion is to go into all of them if you can. And even if that means counselling any time we get together, that's fine by us, because that's what we would do if we were in that emotion. So but what you bring up is exactly a way that often things pan out. We have the emotion come up, we realise that it's not so loving, and so what we try to do then is we try to skip over it and act loving, even though we still feel in our heart, no, I don't want that to happen.
Yeah.
We'd be better off actually living in the truth of, no, I don't want that to happen, and actually connecting with that emotionally as to why we don't want that to happen and fully allowing ourselves to experience that. Yeah.
Okay.
Do you want to say any more about it, Christina?
No.
But it's lovely that you express that openly, because that's a good example of what we're speaking of. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Nikki. Okay, is there any other questions about that anyone would like to ask? Nicole, thank you.
It's a personal question. It's not exactly about this,
yep.
But it's generally about love and donations.
Yes.
If I might, I can ask it now?
Yes, yes.
Okay. Yep. I've recently stopped working with my father's company.
Yep.
And started doing massage, yep. Which I really wanted to do.
Which you really love. Yep.
Yeah. Now, I'm a little bit in a conflict there because I don't know, is it completely unloving to take money for it? Because, like, this is now my conflict a little bit because I still have to live. I still have quite some expenses every month. you know, everyone knows that.
Can I give you a very quick answer?
Yes, please.
It's unloving to demand money for it.
Right.
It's not unloving to take money when it's offered to you.
Yeah.
There's a big difference. So in other words, if we were placing a demand upon people that they give to us, then that is an unloving demand. And what I would do, see, the human race has huge emotions about money. Yeah. Often our emotions about money are so intense that we're totally willing to sacrifice love in order to receive money. And when I say totally willing to sacrifice love, we're willing to sacrifice so many things for the sake of money on the planet.
Yeah.
You know, the reality is thousands and thousands of people die in every country every year because the hospital system wants money. Mm. Not for any other reason. Mm. It's because they just can't pay for the services that they need in order to survive, and they die. That's how strong our Earth's injuries about money are. We'd prefer that they pay money, and we win. And like in the USA, as Michael would know, you get locked out of hospital if you don't have healthcare cover. You get prevented from even entering some hospitals, a lot of hospitals in the US, without any healthcare cover. Because, so what's that about? Unless there's the money, we're not doing a humanitarian service. Yeah. That's what that's about. And the reality is, on the Earth, we have huge issues with money. Yeah. Huge issues. My suggestion is try to deal with those emotions as soon as you can, because they're the emotions that prevent abundance in your life. They prevent abundance. Yeah. So the truth is that you can place a donation box, or even this is the truth, you can even demand money from people and still not get it for a service.
Yeah.
Right? I've seen many people in business do work for money. And because of a number of different emotional issues they have personally, they actually create nobody paying them, right?
Right.
But when you give up the demand for money, it's very interesting because now the money you receive will be based upon the worth you feel you have.
Right.
And that's very confronting emotionally to deal with. Because when I did that, the first thing I received was no money. So I used to earn lots of money. I used to be a computer consultant, and I had my own company, and my hourly rate was $300 Australian an hour. That was my hourly rate, and many people felt I was worth it. I was very good at what I did. I could often set up like 8 to 10 servers all at once at the same time, and doing all sorts of things. So I was very, very productive. A lot of times, far more productive than a person charging 1/3 of that price. But you know, I thought that was pretty good place, right? And I also used to do a bit of property development. And in property development, I used to earn $10,000 very quickly. Like when I say very quickly, you know, sometimes, well, one job I did 20 hours and I earned $220,000 from 20 hours of my time. So that was quite productive, right? Now, when I gave up the demand that other people pay me, I went from that to receiving those kind of funds to receiving nothing.
Right.
And for quite a few years, not a single person donated to me at all. Mm. Yeah? And that went on for nearly 4 or 5 years. Yeah? I spent all the money that I'd earned previously as a result by living and travelling and so forth, and eventually I ended up with no money at all. It was when I ended up with no money that I dealt with the emotion. Ironically. And once I started dealing with the emotions, so many different emotions came up for me. And in fact, in the end, one of the biggest emotions that came up for me was that actually my death in the first century was the result of money. The reality is, when I died in the first century, it was totally because the Sanhedrin, of which the Sadducees were the leaders, felt that if I continued to be allowed to preach the what I called at the time the good news of the kingdom, the good news of truth, if I was allowed to continue preaching that good news, they in the end would have all of their money sources destroyed. That's what they felt.
Right.
And so what finished up happening was that they decided that it was better to kill me, and it was a purely economic decision. Killing me was an economic decision in the first century by the Sanhedrin. Yeah. It was barely even a religious decision, because many of them had no religious thought in their brain or in their heart. You know, they were both basically quite authoritarian, autocratic, and very money-hungry people. And so that was the reason for my death. And so, so I had to process a heap of emotions about even my own death was a result of people basically with money. And I had a big rage about money itself. Like, why do we need it? We shouldn't need it. We should be able to get, a, you know, all those kind of feelings. And once I get rid of all of those feelings, after that we started to receive some donations to survive. Yeah. So my suggestion for your own self is that when you change from doing things for money into doing things voluntarily, you will, if you deal with the money issues inside of your soul, you will in fact get enough money to survive. If you don't deal with the things within your soul, you definitely will be triggered and you won't get the money until you deal with those emotions.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
The other side of it is passion. When a person is in their passion, it's highly likely they will get enough money to do their passion. That's the irony of the universe. Yeah. If you have a look at many of the very rich people on the planet, many of them are in their passions really full on. Like they spend 90, 100, 120 hours doing their thing, you know, because they love doing it. And because of that, they become quite wealthy as well. But they don't do it because they want to be wealthy. They just do it because they love whatever it is that they're doing.
Yeah.
And that's the other lesson to learn about money, is when you do what you love, rather than do rather than compromise, you will in fact get money as a result.
Thank you.
Michael, you had a question associated with
it. Folks in the US that listen will know, well, I wanted to say anybody can go to the emergency room and get treatment for free, but then you have a huge bill, and to see a follow-up specialist, you need money or coverage.
Exactly. And you still have a huge bill.
Yes.
You know, and a poor fella off the street who might be living, you know, very next to nothing, he can't afford to pay that bill. This is the irony of most of what we do on this earth. Water, we charge for. We buy water. Like, you need water every day. Like, within a few days, if you don't have water, you die. Right? And you know, you can die from dehydration, right? Very rapidly. And yet we have to pay for water? And there's so much water on the planet, but we pay for it. Now, doesn't that show you how deep our injury about money is, that even in this life essential, we're asking people to pay for? That's crazy, in my opinion. Then food. Let's look at all of us need food, and we've got to pay for it. How crazy is that? Like, and then all of us at some point, because of our emotional injuries, need some health care of some kind, and we've got to pay for that as well. All of these life essential things we've got to pay for. Now, this is wrong. Like, you know, I can understand you wanting having to pay for a painting or a car or something that's not so much a life essential item. But these life essential things, we should be giving money to the farmers to produce. We should be giving, you know, money to the people who refine the water. And then we should just be freely distributing that water to everybody involved. When it comes to other things that are not necessities, then I can understand, yes, you know, sure, let's maybe charge them if that's what you want to do. But the reality is, we have become so distorted in our economies that we now charge people for the very essentials of life. And that is just ludicrous when you think about it. Yeah.
I also wanted to ask, thank you, AJ, about money and your anger. People often justify you're overturning the tables in the temple as Jesus showed anger, and so they can feel anger.
I know
can
they
you
justify
say something
that.
About that?
Yeah, the reality is I didn't ever overturn the money changers' temples. What actually happened was I just had a discussion with everybody in the temple that I've just had with you. I said, does this feel right to be charged for a dove that's going to require, you know, that's required by law for you to sacrifice in order to, you know, to be forgiven? And does this seem right to you that you get charged 10 times the amount for the dove because it's in the temple, when you can just go out on the street right outside the temple and pay 1/10 of the price, and yet they won't let you sacrifice that dove, and yet the actual law said that you can sacrifice any dove? And that's all I said. Now, people were so angry about it that they all started to go, you know, they start talking about, yes, this is terrible. And they got so enraged about it that they went through the whole temple chucking out the money changers.
Oh, your audience, the people you were speaking
audience.
To.
They to. They just got angry and off they went. and threw out the money changers.
And you got the blame.
And I got the blame, yeah. That's right.
Thanks.
Yeah. Does that make sense to you as to what happened there? So the reality is I wasn't angry. I just stated the truth about how the people were treating the money issue. Does that make sense? And because of how people were just ignoring a basic thing that they were all angry about, me just stating the truth caused them to feel their anger, and then they reacted. Yeah. You want to ask another question?
And the sacrifice wasn't necessary or wasn't useful either. Did you address that?
I often address that. In fact, I said that God would prefer obedience rather than sacrifice.
Obedience.
So what I meant by that was that God had a whole heap of laws, and if you obeyed those laws, you wouldn't need to sacrifice anything. You wouldn't even need to ask for forgiveness because you're no longer committing a sin. That's the irony, right? So what I was talking about with God was that God require what God wants is obedience to the laws of love, rather than sacrificing because you didn't obey the laws of love. So what religion has got used to doing on this planet is they've gotten used to doing things wrong and then paying the penalty for the thing wrong after it's done. Do you see that? Like, you think of most religions on the planet, you know, there is this process where, well, you look at the largest churches, for example, like the Catholic Church, for example. There's the confession. Right? So you do the wrong thing, because you can't help yourself, of course, right? And then you confess to it, and then you do a few Hail Marys, and right? And off you go, because you've been forgiven. And the priest says, I absolve you from your sin. As if the priest can absolve them from anything, right? Now the problem with that whole teaching is that it encourages people to sin and then to feel bad about the sin and then to sacrifice, in other words, to confess and own up to the sin and then be absolved. And that, what's that going to do? Just encouraging the sin some more. The reality is that when you encourage a person to obey the law, then they don't need to sin, and therefore they never need a sacrifice, and they'll never need to ask for forgiveness. That's a better place to be, obviously. Now the church has created that other place, that alternate existence, because they had a lot of power in that place. You can make people feel guilty. You can make them feel bad. You can ask money from them to absolve their sins and so forth. You know, there's a lot of things you can do once a person feels guilty and feels like they have to sacrifice.
There's some hands over here.
Sorry?
There's some hands up over here.
To okay. Ask?
She wants to go out.
You need to go out. Yeah. Yep. Love you, Karen. So we just this way. Is there a way out through down there, down the side there? Or is it? Okay. Have we exhausted that subject? No, we have not.
Perry. Hand up for a while.
You've had your hand up for a bit.
Hi. Just on the subject of money again.
Yeah.
Since we're on the topic. And 3 years ago, I declared bankruptcy.
Yep.
And so I've had an issue with money for a number of years until the point where I couldn't take it anymore, the pressure. So I declared bankruptcy. It felt the right thing to do at the time. And it was around that time that I was changing my jobs from an old job, from working in bars and restaurants, into a more natural way of living, working in, with nature and things. And so since then, my family see me as the one who's not earning the money, and I really feel it. And my brother actually makes quite a bit of money. And just to kind of share a story, my brother said, hey, Perry, there's a chance for you to earn some money here on eBay. You can sell some tickets. And then you sell them later on when they're not available anymore. So I was going, okay, well, this is not really my passion. But maybe I'm just scared of...
So some ticket scalping.
But then I thought to myself, maybe I'm just scared of stepping into that businessman role. And it's actually okay to buy and sell that way. So I did it anyway. So he bought 20 tickets and I bought 10 tickets. And he sold all of his tickets within a week and I didn't sell any of my tickets. And then I gave my tickets to him to sell on his eBay account and he sold them all in about 4 days.
Exactly.
And it just really showed me that if you're not doing your passion, then the money doesn't come anyway.
Exactly. Do you know the emotions that you have about it?
Well, I think it's interesting because I had a dream last night which showed me some of the things. And I think it's to do with like stepping into my greatness of what I feel. And I'm scared to feel that I can step into my power. And my dream was last night is that we actually had some personal time with you. And we were walking to a seminar. And I was surprised that you were walking next to me. So there's like expectations of, oh, I'm just walking next to Jesus. That's okay.
Somebody's got it.
And then actually, you actually lit a cigarette and you started to smoke. And I was like, I was like, oh, that's strange. Jesus is smoking a cigarette. So I was like, oh, that's just my expectations of what I thought Jesus would be like. And then you explained because you're so loving, that it can't affect you anyway.
Right.
So it doesn't matter what's coming into you. You're so loving that you could just purify it. So I was like, oh, okay. And then, so we got to the seminar and we started to have a conversation because just yesterday you asked me what I did for a living. And I was talking about I was gardening. So I don't passionately love it right now. And so I don't earn a lot of money at all. And I told you that I was really passionate about these subjects, talking about God and the seminars and everything. But I didn't tell you my true passion would be to work like you do. And discuss and teach these teachings and become available and live that way. Like it really feels like a really strong desire for me for years. But only till I met you and this kind of scenery, it kind of hit me. I was like, okay, this is what I'd like to do. But I didn't tell you that yesterday, but in my dream I told you. So when we got to the seminar, you said, okay, we're going to do the seminar now. And Perry's going to do it. and you winked at me and told me, you see how powerful your law of attraction can be when you when you express your full desire. And then I just went petrified and was just like, oh, I can't do that. And so it showed me that I'm scared to actually step into the power which I feel I could deliver. And I'm scared of that.
And most people are, Perry, Most people are very afraid of taking that step through that fear. And just doing it anyway, and letting like we talked about yesterday, letting the desire bring up, as Mary pointed out.
You know,
yesterday,
we talked about the step into your desire, and then be humble to what the law of attraction brings you in that place. So,
what the law of attraction brought you in your dream was fear, because I say, well, Perry's doing the talk now, so you expressed the desire. I said, well, and basically the way I treat that is, I go, well, does Perry really have the desire? Let's put him in the situation to see whether he's got the desire or not, right? And when you get placed in the situation, there is when all the fear gets triggered. And that shows you why you don't have a pure desire yet about the that desire being followed. However, I don't believe that any of what you've said has anything to do with why you had a bankruptcy 3 years ago.
Okay.
You have another emotion about money. There's a very powerful emotion that's causing a lot of your rejection of money. Can you feel what it is?
About money itself.
About money itself.
About money itself.
Yeah.
The monetary system.
At the time, actually, what happened was I felt I was tricked into getting the loans.
Yeah.
And I felt quite angry, actually, in the end, toward the banks. Yeah. For them, like.
So go with the anger, because the anger is very good. It leads you to a place where you find out the real emotion.
Yeah. So. And I felt tricked by them.
Yeah.
And, like, they were able to trick me into that for my lack of intelligence around money and how logic it can be and to do with numbers and all those things. And so I felt like they tricked me into getting the loans.
It's even, there's even more than this, because it's related to your family, your father and your brother in particular. Can you feel, what are their emotions towards money and yours in comparison?
Well, my dad, I don't know, because I haven't, he left when I was about 10.
Yep.
So we didn't have a proper relationship.
Yep. What's your brother reflects your father's opinion. So okay. What's his opinion?
Well, my brother loves money right now.
Yeah, he loves money, but
yeah.
But what does he do?
As a profession.
What does he do with money? He basically is an opportunist with money, isn't he?
Well, he kind of wastes it right now in my eyes.
Sorry?
He wastes money in my eyes right
well,
now.
Well, yeah, he has plenty to waste, but but the issue is how does he get it? He gets it through opportunity, doesn't he?
Well, his main profession is a tennis coach, so he gets it. It's a quite high-paid job, and he actually loves playing tennis from being a child. So he actually, through his passion of teaching tennis, he gets the money.
But that doesn't cause him to ticket scalp on the internet.
No, he saw that as because he wanted to, because he has a side business also now selling property.
Yes.
So he got into the tickets first, and now he sells property.
Yes.
So it was like a progression.
So how does he view money?
I think he uses it as power, actually.
Yeah, see, what you're trying to do is you're trying to say to yourself that his view of money has some kind of negative connotations, but I'm suggesting to you that actually the fact that money comes to him quite easily means that he obviously has less injuries towards money than you do, right? Otherwise, the money wouldn't come to him quite easily. He would have more injuries if it didn't come easily. Like, so he has less injuries about money than you do. So the question then becomes, how do you feel about money in comparison to how he feels about it? Now, you have a very strong rebellious feeling towards money.
Okay.
You don't want to take any responsibility for any money. You don't like the idea of money very much at all. You have what I would say most New Age people have a feeling towards money, and that is a feeling that, they'd rather see the earth devoid of it. There's quite a lot of anger in it as well, like this, and a feeling that I shouldn't have to, the feeling I was just voicing with Michael before, I shouldn't have to pay money for things like this or things like that, and I should be able to get a loan, and it should be interest free, and things like that. That's the feelings you have.
Yeah.
So that creates a lot of that means there's a lot of resentment towards money inside of you. Now, if you resent something, does it feel attracted to you?
No, logically.
Logically.
But what you're saying, actually, I, in my mind, I think that I love money. Like, I wouldn't mind to have lots of money in my mind and the way I feel.
When we talk about this with an audience and you ask, does everybody think they love money? And they all put up their hand, yes, I'm happy with having more money, How many of you would like to receive $1 million right at this point? And most people will put up their hands and say, $1 million, if there's no string attached, I'd definitely go for that,
I'll freak out because I've got the same emotion as you. Like, how do I deal with it? What do I do with it? Where do I put it? What's the rules with that?
Now, for most people, they put up their hand, but the reality is that, millions of dollars are handed around on this planet every single moment of the day. And how come it's not handed into your hand? There's got to be a reason. Now, sure, some of the reasons are that the economic system is quite highly distorted and quite unloving, and so therefore it's only the people who are in the unloving space that might receive some of it, but that doesn't account for all of the money and where it goes. So we've got to, because there's plenty of people who are in their passion and desire and in a pure passion and desire who do receive money. So we've got to start questioning, well, why is it that we don't receive money if that's the case? And like I said to you, I had to go through lots of other emotions, emotions about my rage with money, about my rage with the system. The you know, when you're enraged with something, you don't love it. Isn't that true? You're angry with it, you're not loving it. Now, if you're angry with money, the money system, how it all works and all those kind of things, then you don't love it. Mm-hmm. If you also are enraged with your family because of the competition emotion. So, for example, if you feel competitive with your brother because he has money and you do not, or he's looked upon as being better than you because he can get money and you can't, then straight away you can see there's quite a lot of emotions involved in the issue of money. It's a measure. Today on the planet, money is one of the main measures of worth. So it's very rare to go up to a person and say, "G'day, how you going?" What, you know, we often then say, well, "What do you do?" And if they say, "Oh, I'm a bum who lives on the side. who lives on the beach at Cactus Beach in South Australia," or, you know, many of you would never have heard of that place, but it's a famous surf beach in Australia. Everyone goes, anyone who is anyone in the planet goes, yeah, he's a bit of a slacker, right? Like, most people don't have respect for that kind of a person who are in the money system. You got me? But if you say, oh, yeah, I manage 5 companies and I'm a director of this and I do that and I do that, everyone goes, wow, you know, he deserves my respect. So even respect is given based on money and power on the planet that we have today. Can you see how that highly distorts a person's worth? Their real worth, from God's perspective, is based on their condition, their soul condition. But we don't see their soul condition at all. All we see is what they've created and how we judge the worth of the person based on what worth they have, their net worth, if you like. Now, many of us have a deep rage about that. And anger about that is the case, that things are just judged on that basis. And our own anger in itself will prevent us from receiving money. There are so many emotions involved in money, power, control, feeling, all sorts of emotions that we need to address. And the irony is that when you start addressing them, you will be able to live your life in passion, and people will just want to give you money to help you do that. But not before you deal with the emotion. You have to deal with the emotion. You can't intellectualize it out of you. You can't do something differently. You have to actually change something at the soul level. So for any person who's not in a place where they've got enough wealth to even enjoy their life, my suggestion, particularly in the Western world, is a bit different perhaps in the Eastern, in other places of the country, you know, the third world, because obviously the third world is getting heavily raped by the Western world. So they're already in a system that's being raped monetarily. But in the Western world, there is money available, and we've got to start questioning when we don't receive it. We do have to question what's going on for myself there. I don't know about you, but I've donated to many causes in my life. Some causes have been individuals that I've donated to, like, somebody wanted a car, so I give them a car, somebody, and so forth. And all I do is I look at the desire and the worthiness of the cause, and then I give my funds based on the worthiness of that cause. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Now, there's many other people on the planet who do the same thing. And so if we embrace a worthy cause as a desire inside of ourselves, we have a passionate desire to fulfill that worthy cause, it's highly unlikely, if we do it in purity and in love, that we won't receive funds from some source. Highly unlikely. We just have to deal with the emotions that are making it all impure. And that's what most of us avoid. And so when we don't deal with those emotions, and so then we start charging for our service, or we start doing things that then fit into the system we're currently in. And my suggestion is, if you fit into the system you're currently in, you will survive monetarily most of the time, particularly if you're willing to work, but you will not be following your passions and desires, and you won't deal with the reasons why money just isn't flowing when you do what you desire. So it's really important. I feel the money issue is a major issue of lack of love on the planet. In the end, we won't use money on the planet because we won't need to. I'll do my passion because I'm passionate about it, and you'll want what I do because I'm passionate about it and because it has some benefit to society, and then you'll give me what you can give me that's out of your passion. So if your passion was growing food, then I'd get some of your food because that was your passion, you know? And if your passion was cleaning up the environment, then I'd get some of that as well in return, you know? And it's not a bartering system, it's just we both want to give each other that gift of what we're passionate about. And that would automatically happen in a society that wasn't based on the economies that we have now. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But many of us have that ideal in our heart, and then we get really angry the fact that the world's not like that. And that's the source of us not having money many times, because anything we're angry with is not loving. So if I'm angry with the world in the way it is now, I'm not loving the world in the way it is now. The world won't change unless I love it.
So with the emotional processing, if I wasn't aware of my anger to the monetary system, and I don't feel that I can get angry at to release my anger, like I'm feeling I don't know how to release my anger about what you just suggested.
Well, just go back 3 years in time and remember the feelings you had when you had to go bankrupt.
Right.
And start there. Mm-hmm. And the feeling was that you'd been duped and ripped off.
Yeah.
Start there. Let yourself fully feel that feeling instead of skipping over it.
And then the process is just to feel those feelings. This is how it works.
Feel the feelings.
Yeah.
And then feel why you feel angry. See, it's no good just to feel the anger without understanding why.
Mm-hmm.
And then see how that relates to anything within your childhood and anything in your current life. If you look at your family, they are very focused on money being the measure of true worth.
Okay.
And you have less worth than your brother in the eyes of your family. And how does that feel? Doesn't that hurt?
I mean, I think I'm at a stage now where I don't fully feel less worth. It feels like that to me.
No. If that was the case, you'd be receiving money. You see, the problem is with a lot of our progression is we tell ourselves a story thinking we've completed an emotion when the law of attraction is demonstrating something entirely different to us. Can you see?
Mm-hmm.
So we've got to be very honest about seeing our law of attraction. If I say, I've dealt with all my mother issues, and every single day I still get angry women projecting anger at me. Have I dealt with my mother issues? No, I haven't. If I've dealt with all my money issues and I still have no money, then have I dealt with my money issues? No, I haven't. If I've dealt with my worth issues but I still feel like I'm not worthy enough to receive, then have I dealt with my worth issues? My law of attraction is telling me the truth as to the real place I'm in. The problem with us a lot of the times is we distance ourselves through time and also through much intellectual exercise, we distance ourselves from the emotion we feel. And then we tell ourselves we've resolved it. Right? You'd be surprised in the course of all of our talking that how often Mary and I get told, somebody comes up to us and says, oh, I want to talk to you about this particular issue. They start talking, don't they? And then within a few moments we say, well, can you just stop? I can give you the answer of what, you know, the emotion is, if you wish, you know. So we give them the answer. And they say, no, I've already dealt with that emotion. And then we go, no, because your law of attraction is showing you that you still have the emotion. So you mustn't have dealt with it. Oh, no, they say. No, they'll argue now, from now on. They'll argue and they'll go, no, 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 that's not the case. That's just other people around me that are like that. That's other people doing that to me now. And I'm saying, but no, no. They wouldn't be doing it to you if it were. This is the law of attraction affecting your life. Oh, no, you know, and then they're so resistive that they'll even enter an argument saying and trying to prove that their life has changed somehow and they have dealt with that emotion, when the reality is their very law of attraction that they've come to discuss with us is telling them that it hasn't been dealt with. So one thing I'd recommend to all of you is to take a lot of notice of what happens in your day-to-day life. Take a lot of notice about what happens, because what happens in your day-to-day life tells you the truth about what is actually going on, whether you've dealt with something or not. The only way I know whether I've dealt with things or not is by my law of attraction telling me whether I've dealt with it or not.
And does emotional processing, can it go in stages?
Yes.
Because I feel I'm stronger than I was.
I definitely agree with that.
Because I feel now I'm just stable. You know, I can afford food. Yes. I don't get scared ordering a drink and things.
Yes.
But it's, I still have a desire to be more abundant.
Yes.
So it's not as powerful as where I want to be, but it's better than where I was.
Where you were, yes.
Yes.
And please bear in mind this with all of our progression. It is a progression. It's not like, it's very rarely you go from here to, you know, you imagine a stairwell there, you know, this stairwell over here. For me to get from here right up to there in one step is pretty hard, right? But the steps are there, right? So for me to get to there using the steps is pretty easy, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Right, so this is what your life is like, right? We need to remember that. See, well, a lot of times we make this step and we go, I've resolved that issue. And where do we stay on the stairwell? Where I am. Not because I don't want to conceive, I don't want to be aware that I could make another step and be even better off. And I could make another step and be even better off. And it's very unlikely that I'm ever going to make that kind of a step. Mm-hmm. And it actually be successful, right? It may happen sometimes, but it's pretty unlikely. And it's exactly the same with your processing emotionally. It's very hard for you to make these huge jumps, these huge leaps emotionally. And the reason why is because there's a lot of emotion in between there and there that we need to work our way through in a sincere and truthful manner. So we are in our progression going to be doing this. It's be stepping up. If you think about it, we're stepping up in conditions of love as we're stepping up in our progression. And it's going to be like that. It's going to be, we're going to be able to look back and go, I definitely have changed from that point. I can now see more where I am. I've got more awareness now of where I am. I've definitely changed from that point. But I also realize there's still another step to make, and when I get to that step, now I can see things that I couldn't see when I was there, right? And your progression is going to be everlastingly like that, eternally like that. And this is what we need to come to terms, this is why we need to come to terms with change, because anybody that doesn't come to terms with change makes a step like that and they go, oh boy, that was so hard, that was so difficult, I don't know how I ever managed doing that, you know, and now look at me now, isn't it wonderful, I've made this wonderful progress and I'm just so fantastic now, and there's no need for me to progress any further, right? And then 100 years later, because that's how long it's going to take them to get out of that emotion probably, they go like this, and they go, oh, I never knew that would be the case. So I don't, you know, and then they rave on about how great that was and that step that they made and whatever else. And the reality is it's our own emotional state that's slowing down our progression. The truth is when we walk upstairs, walking through our emotions is like walking upstairs. The reality is you can keep going. Right, up the stairs. You can keep progressing and it'll be a slow and steady progress. What happens with most people is we make one step, we look at the step first and then we go, look at that step, it's too high for me, I can't handle that, yeah, I don't want to do that, can somebody else lift me up for please? And they go, what? You know, they say, you know, you're not going to get much help doing that. And you're looking at the step and you say, you kick the step and you want this step to destroy, you get out the axe and try to cut the step out. Yeah, you do all sorts of things because you just don't want to make the step. And then you decide at the end of all of that resistance, so usually that resistance takes a long time, right? At the end of all of that resistance, you go, Perhaps I should take the step. So you take the step, and then we want the reward from everyone around us. Right? So we tell everybody how great this step was. Isn't it wonderful? You give me the emotions of approval and acceptance, and I'll feel good about the step, and I can stay on this step for ages, just waiting on this step, waiting for everybody to give me all of that stuff. And all I'm doing is stopping my next step. I'm slowing down. And then when I turn around and look at the next step, I do the same as what I did with this one. Try to cut it out first, you know, and try to kick it and kick it down and do all sorts of things, because I don't want to make that one either. And this is the reason why most people on a divine love path are struggling. Because we hit every step that we need to take in love. We complain and are bitter about it, firstly. We go through all this process of resistance. Then we realize we have to do it, so we do it. Then we want the glory and adulation from everyone else that we've done it. Isn't it wonderful? Right? That's how we go. And we stay there trying to get all of this emotion of, isn't it wonderful, aren't I wonderful, I've made all this progression, tell me that I'm wonderful, please, otherwise I'm going to, you know, step down, and so forth. And we get to that point, and all we're doing with all of this shenanigans, which is all this shenanigans...
Carry on,
like, you know, it's like romanticising the whole process, if you like. All I'm doing is I'm preventing my own joy by slowing down my own progress. That's all I'm doing. And I'd be far better off not involving anybody else in the process, looking at the step and going, isn't that wonderful? I've got a step towards God. I've got a step towards love that I can choose to step onto, and I'll have to deal with some emotions, and releasing those errors is going to be a bit painful. So I feel that pain because I'm ready and willing to feel the pain. And when I get to this step, I don't go to everybody, look at me, aren't I good? I've got the next step done. Isn't it wonderful? Please tell me that it's wonderful. I just look at the front and I go, wow, I've got another step. I can be closer to God again. I can be closer to love again. I can be closer to more happiness again if I take this next step. Now, do you think you'd be pausing at every step if you were doing that? Now, when it comes to our progression with regard to any emotion, including the emotions with regard to money, including any emotion we can think of, we are often so resistive to each step, and we tell ourselves at the end that we've taken one step and then we're finished. We tell ourselves we're finished, we're over it now, when the reality is that our law of attraction, which is a very powerful tool God has given us to measure our progress up the stairwell, the law of attraction is telling us that, no, I'm sorry, you have made some progress on this issue, which is fantastic, which will result in some level of joy, but you still have more progress to make on this issue before you become more loving.
And maybe if you go back to the staircase. What you demonstrated there is a shift that I feel a lot of us need to make on the path.
Yeah.
And that is even... If when you were taking...
Myself and Mary were discussing this morning, in fact.
Yeah. When you're taking this step, the first step, and you look around at everyone else to say, look how I've made this step, you're demonstrating how invested you still are in the world around you.
And everybody approving of you.
And you're not looking up the staircase to your destination, which is God, or this connection with God. And it's, for me, making that transition from facing... this way.
Yeah, isn't it wonderful?
to facing way, that way.
And being purposeful.
And that's the humble place for me, you know. That's recognizing that there's not just one step, there's a staircase in front of me. And that's God is the ultimate loving force in the universe. And this is where I'm at in the staircase. So it's not taking a step and going, wow, I'm so developed now. Check it out, everyone. I'm a step up. You know, it's taking a step and going, wow, you know, there's so much there for me to learn and grow. And it keeps us humble in the stepping, but it also, the rewards, if we rely on the rewards from this direction all of the time, from the people around us, we're very dependent on their emotional condition. We're dependent on their presence in our life. If we face that way, there's this growing relationship that becomes more and more rewarding through our remaining humble. Yeah.
When I was younger, people used to laugh at me a lot because I never used to take a lift, right? And I still very rarely take one, as Mary knows. Like, because
what do you mean by taking a lift?
I lift, you know, like a lift to go up elevator.
Yeah.
Right, you call it. Yep. We call it lifts in Australia. But we would never go up an elevator. I would take the stairs, and I have that attitude to pretty much everything. Like, I love going up the stairs. It gives me a lot of joy going up the stairs, believe it or not. Because you get to see what you're doing. It's like climbing. It's like climbing a mountain. You go higher and higher and higher. There's a physical effect on your body, which you start to connect to your body and really enjoy. Just the act of climbing a stair is, and particularly a high one, is really wonderful. Now, if we need to have that same viewpoint in the stairwell of life, if you like, in our stairwell to God. Which is basically an everlasting progression. We need to have the viewpoint that we love the process of doing it. We're not addicted to the end goal. Do you follow me? But we're rather loving the process. And what I find is most people are opposite to that. They're addicted to getting the end result without enjoying. And learn and enjoying the process of learning the process of learning the unfoldment of the process. And this is where we've got to be careful. A lot of times we want to be told, but I have made some progress. And yes, of course, it's highly unlikely the way God works that anybody on the planet hasn't made some progress. Because God's like a great big magnet at the top of all of this, trying to suck us up, you know. Or you can think of a great big vacuum cleaner trying to suck us up into God, right? And so there's so much, let's call it attraction from God towards humanity to pull us up. That's the reason why we make progress. We don't make progress for anything we do on our own, actually. We make progress only because that God is higher than we are, and that's the source of all love, and we'll be drawn to it eventually like a magnet. So the fact is that God's there like with this great big vacuum cleaner, vacuum, trying to vacuum us up, and we're spending most of that time in resistance trying to stay away from the flow of that love that comes from God. We're trying to stay away from it completely because of fear, generally, that's the thing, or even because we want to be told how good we are that we've done one little step, when the reality is all of our steps are going to come through God's help anyway. Right. So don't get addicted to being told even that, you know, you've done something up till now. Isn't that great? Right? Understand you have made progress. Measure your progress. What I do myself is I go, right, have I made progress on this issue over the last year? Do I feel different on this issue? Now, to be frank with you, there are some issues that I've been working on now for 3 or 4 years and I have made no progress on them at all. Right? There's one issue in particular that's pretty outstanding for me that I have not made any progress on for the last 3 or 4 years. There are other issues that I have. Now, if you want to falsify where you've made progress and where you haven't, it's going to be very counterproductive to your future. You're better off just being really honest and open about, yes, I've made progress here, but I definitely have not made progress here. And I don't mean in a judgmental way. Don't do that in a judgmental way. Just in an analytical way. Proof that you haven't made progress is your law of attraction. That's proof. You haven't made progress on that particular issue. So let yourself feel the full effect of the proof. And if you feel angry about it, then be angry about it. And if you feel disappointed in yourself, feel disappointed in yourself. If you feel sad, have a cry. And then accept the truth. I have not made progress on that particular issue for that whole time. But then there are other things where you definitely will have made progress. And you've also got to be honest about that. You've got to stop telling yourself that you haven't made any. Many of you have made much progress, right, over the years. There's some issues that you haven't, but many of you have made progress in some places. So tell yourself you have on those particular things. But if you want somebody else to tell you you've made progress, then I suggest to you that you may have not made as much progress on that point as you think you have. Right? Yeah.
Couple of Aussies. Can we go,
Dennis, over there?
And we're nearly due for a break.
Yeah, I just wonder whether you could sing "Stairway to Heaven."
I don't feel like singing it today. One day we'll have to. You know, once we get the God's Way of Love band happening, you know, then
they can accompany the seminars. Then, you know, cue to them.
And once I deal with my female based emotions, which are the ones I'm stuck on, and I'll be able to sing properly for a change. And once we do that, I'd love to be the lead singer in the band, at least for that song.
That's when the song and dance routines come back.
Yeah. It's funny, in Australia at the moment, we have a team in the God's Way of Love called the Arts Team. And the Arts Team, if you've read about it on the internet, is looking at things like music, art and stuff like that, right? And I made a suggestion to the leader of the Arts Team that she has auditions to actually have a concert, right? Now, almost everyone in the Arts Team is up in arms. Why does AJ suggest an audition? And to be frank with you, this is why I suggested an audition. Because I don't want to sit down and listen to somebody sing terribly and play terribly for a whole night. Do you? It's an unloving thing to expect other people to put up with our poor performances. And that's one of the reasons why I can't sing Stairway to Heaven right at this point. It would be very unloving of me to embrace it.
Can I talk about the stair analogy and ask a question about
the stair analogy? The stair analogy.
And ask a
Don't take an analogy too far, though, Anna, will you?
I love analogies, yeah, so I probably do. I don't know when too far is.
Yeah.
With self-punishment, like, Mary, have you found, like, that when you stopped focusing on the people around you, then you stopped self-punishing?
Yeah. For those of you who don't know me very well, self-punishment's a bit of something that I've really struggled with. Just having very high expectations for myself and feeling when I'm not getting there that I would self-punish. And a lot of it was to do with feeling that I got my parents' approval when I self-punished as a kid, if I did something not good enough or well. So disconnecting from their expectations and their my hooks into them, if you like, helped. Probably did, Anna, a lot. Yep.
I feel with self-punishment what happens a lot is it's like you make the step in progress, but you don't acknowledge that you've made that progress.
Yeah,
and like you're like, I'm not on the stage yet.
Yeah, I'm not up here yet.
Like, and it's almost like you sink down to the next level down just because you feel so. Like,
well, the only reason why you would sink back down is because of any negative influence that overcloaks you.
Yeah.
So when a spirit overcloaks you negatively and start, so once you go into self-punishment, now you're leaving an opening for a spirit to punish you as well, and that will certainly cause you at times to go back down and harm others.
Now we're starting to labour the analogy, but anyway. It's more like for me when I take the step, it's hard to take the step back down, apart from, as AJ says, with the spirit influence, but it's like some of this self-punishment is when I don't want to see how many steps there are left to go. Like, I want to go, like, I'm not on the stage and I don't even want to see how many steps there are and I'm just terrible and I can't, you know, a lot of my self-punishment was also just avoidance of seeing the truth. I thought if I just blame myself more, I can avoid just seeing the reality of what's really there, you know. It's definitely, as you are aware, an avoidance emotion, like a self-deceiving emotion. It's not something we have to process. Yeah. But I do think the investment in everyone else, because a lot of our standards come from how everyone else is. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. If we can go up the back. Yep.
Gabrielle.
Hello.
G'day.
What is abundancy and what is home?
Abundance certainly isn't what we view abundance to be.
Exactly. So I get very confused because when you talk about abundancy, I don't know what that means.
Okay.
Okay.
Abundance is when you will continue with every one of your desires without any restrictions. Now, if you just ponder about that for a moment, because I said that quite quickly, and also many of you have gone, what? How does that abundance? Let's ponder about it and reflect upon it. When I am abundant, I will choose to do everything I wish to do that's harmonious with love, and I will not have any restrictions in doing so. Can you see that? I won't see money as money will not be a restriction. I'll have enough money to do exactly what I want.
But it's the view that changes. My injury is I need an extreme abundance of money to be able to do without restriction
exactly
what I want.
Most people only want to embrace their desires once they get the money.
Yeah.
What I'm saying is the true condition of abundance is knowing that God supplies your every need at every moment, so therefore you have an unlimited amount of resources at your disposal. Mm-hmm. Once you're at one with God, you actually see every single thing as a resource available at your disposal to use harmonious with love as you see fit. And you have no restrictions upon it. It's like having, you could think of it like this. It's like having billions and billions and billions and billions of dollars in the bank available to do whatever you wish. But there's no bank. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense? So it's an emotion that exists in you. Once you feel abundant, there's an emotion that comes in you that you now feel unrestricted in every single thing you do. Okay. You don't do it because of a lack of money or because of money. So, for example, you would walk down to the shopping centre and there'd be like $3 cherries, $7 cherries, $12 cherries. Right? The $12 cherries are the export quality cherries, the ones they send overseas to everyone else, right? The $7 cherries are like middle of the road, and the $3 cherries are like the ones that everybody else gets because they're not the perfect cherries, right? Now, when you are in abundance and you love cherries, right, which cherry would you choose?
The 12.
The 12 one, wouldn't you?
Well, whichever ones I want the most.
Well, it would be the 12 because they're the best.
They're the best, yeah.
Yeah. I'm not saying that 12 means automatically best. I mean, you'd look at them and you'd go, yeah, they don't look so good. They look all right. They look amazing. You know what I mean? Yeah, yeah. But what do we do? We go, oh, they look amazing, but they're $12. Yeah. Right? That's not an abundant feeling, is it?
Yes, no.
Right? But when I'm in abundance, I'd go, they look amazing and I love cherries. They're the ones I'm going to buy. Yeah. Right? And I will also have the money to buy them. Because I'm already in abundance anyway. I already have that feeling of abundance inside of me that attracts the abundance I need. So I won't hesitate buying them. I won't even look at the price of which one looks better even. So, you know, you go down the market. What normally happens down the market? You go up the market, down the market, checking all the prices, and you see, ah, oh, this one's $2, this one's $2.20, this one's $2.50, that one's $2.70, that one's $3, and that's $3.50. I'll go to the $2 one. That's not abundance. Abundance is checking, going up and down the market, looking at all the cherries and going, which one's the best? Because that's the one I want, because I love cherries. Now, if you don't love cherries, you're not going to care. But if you love cherries, that's what you would do.
But how do we deal with a false sense of abundance? When I have money, and I have money right now, but I fear it's going to run out, and then it's like, it's like an emotion I can't face.
Yeah, I don't think that's called a false sense of abundance. I think that's called fear.
Yeah, okay.
So
no, but meaning when I'm in this state of like, oh, I have money right now, then I'm not very, oh, I'll take this and that. I don't look too much at, you know,
yeah,
I don't obsess
too much. Yeah, a false
sense
of abundance is when, what you say, or fear-based, abundance is when we have a bank account that's got money in it.
Yeah.
And we know we've got money in it, so we go out and spend that money how we see fit.
I feel safe.
You feel safe doing
it. Yeah.
Well, when you have no bank account,
right,
you have a sense of abundance, you will go out and still spend the same amount of money because that's what you desired. Yeah. And if you have a sense of abundance, you'll automatically get the money right at the right time to buy for that particular thing.
So at the moment, what does your fear dictate that you do with the money?
Hoard it. But I'm not. I'm spending it. Because I chose. I left work almost 2 years ago.
You've hoarded it to a point.
And now I'm living off of it.
Till you feel safe, then you live off it until you feel unsafe.
Now I'm in that. I'm here this week. Yeah, I'm in that cracking point.
You're in the
unsafe. So I'm like, oh, I'm gonna go back. I gotta get a job. But now I've been on the path too long, and I'm not in my soul if I do that. So, and I'm too afraid to tap into my passions. I'm like all messed up about.
But one reason why you're afraid to tap into your passions is because you get to this point where the the fear of money is still not dealt with.
Yes.
And so eventually it's going to get triggered somehow.
Right.
So what you've done in the past is you've worked till you've got a money buffer.
Yeah.
Right. Then you've taken some time off and do what you like until the money gets to the point of critical mass, shall we call it. Yeah. The point of critical mass is I'm
now
frightened.
I call it the puke point. I know that's kind of vulgar, but we got that.
I'm now frightened. Now my fear will dictate what I do next.
Yes.
Now
I can't seem to get through this right now. Well, that's or I don't want to, let's put it that way.
You don't want to deal with your fear.
Yeah.
Because if you wanted to deal with your fear would not dictate your next move. Your desire would. But for most of us, that never happens. What happens is that we get into the place of fear, the fear dictates the next move, and so we go back to work, earn a bit more money till we get the buffer, and then we do the same thing.
Right. Remember the definition we wrote of God reliance yesterday? There was three main points, and the first one was embracing your passions and desires.
Yes.
And then being humble, and then wanting God's truth, and then you get closer to God and you're looked after. Mm-hmm. If you resist the first point, which is embracing your passions and desires, because the fear is already stopping you, you can't activate this beautiful process that actually really heightens your connection.
I started
with God.
Racing with my passions, but then I started, it triggered me so much. But I kept going because I felt this process. I'm like, this is great, this is great. I'm getting triggered every day. I'm freaking out every day. This is wonderful. But then I got to a point where part of my desire, it's animals. And so there's so much unloving to working with animals.
Yeah.
I said, am I supporting? Then I got into the whole boycott thing.
Yeah.
Oh, so I left. So I'm not following it anymore. So I didn't follow it through this process.
What we said yesterday: follow your desires, be humble to the error, feel the error, but then accept that God's truth, and then practice God's truth. Mm-hmm. So with animals, if you have a love of animals, there's plenty you can do to embrace God's truth. But you have many fears associated with what will the world think of that? What will people think of me doing that? And so forth. Mm-hmm. And that's really what kicks in. Mm-hmm. That's what you're not being humble to.
Well, actually, to be honest, my biggest fear is I'm going to talk to AJ about it and he's going to tell me, oh, your passion, that's very unloving.
Why would you be afraid of me?
I'm afraid to hear because from you that this desire I have is an unloving desire. So all of this work towards this passion goes out the window, and I believe I have spirits a bit have taken a run with this.
So you need to follow your passion, and then if somebody comes along and says, look, that passion is unloving, and they can show you that it's unloving, then just tweak it so it's loving.
I've been going through. It's getting tweaked. I'm getting information in books now that's tweaking it.
Yeah.
Okay. All
so
right.
Act
that
upon.
Makes sense.
Act upon those tweaks.
All right. Great.
And that way your desire becomes more pure. That's the process, step into the desire, be humble to the feedback, modify the desire so it's more loving, and in the end it becomes very powerful.
So a passion to help animals and be with them is, I mean, I know there's a lot of injury involved that I have to work through, but I had an abundance of questions regarding this, and I won't suck up more time, but you wrote yesterday, for example, this could be part of your personality?
Yeah.
Yeah.
The Apostle John, for example, is passionate about animals. Like, in the spirit world, one of John's primary things that he did all the way through his life was with animals. And he now is one of the leaders in the spirit world about animals and creation as a result of his passion. He's always had that passion. It was present in the first century. It was present through his life. It's a part of his personality and nature.
Is there channeled information from him or anything?
I don't believe so.
Oh, okay.
No.
I was just curious if there was something to tap into to read about.
Yeah.
Okay.
Then there's other people who are not passionate about animals so much. They're more passionate about other things.
Yes.
One thing is that you might be passionate about building. And so you love the creative process of building, for example. And so that can be a part of your personality, part of your nature. Embrace it. And wherever it's in error, will be confronted. So confront it, feel the emotions, but still embrace the passion. Don't run away from your passions. Mm. Like, if you run away from your passions, that's when things get very confusing. That's when your soul gets quite dark, in the sense that you feel like, oh, what do I do then? You give up. you know, you don't feel like doing anything in your life, then that, you know, that's a very dangerous time for you. Because other times when you're influenced by others and the world around you to do what they want, you're better off following your passions, following your desires, and letting the law of attraction trigger you with different emotions that you need to purify your love in that desire. But understand that many of your passions are a deep part of your personality.
Okay.
Yeah.
Excellent. Thank you.
Okay, well,
we need to have a break.
I think it's time for a break, eh? We've been well and truly 2 hours, I think.
Yeah.
So we'll have a break for about half an hour and then we'll recontinue.